The partial derivative of u with respect to time plus the spatial derivatives. So there were certain considerations that were put into for arriving at this equation. The first consideration is that we considered that the velocity of the particle, which is actually giving a Lagrangian description of the flow at a given location where the Eulerian description of flow is described, at that location the velocity of the particle is same as the velocity of the flow. So that is how the Eulerian and Lagrangian descriptions merge. In other words, the very consideration that there is no difference between the velocity of a particle, which is that, you know, fluid particle that we are talking about, and the velocity of flow at the instantaneous point where the particle is residing at the moment, that converges the Lagrangian and Eulerian description at a given instant. And of course, the Eulerian description is at a point. So summarily, what we can say is that if we write this expression, we are seeing that there are two important contributions to the acceleration. So first of all, as a formula, it is quite straightforward. So if you know u as a function of x, y, z and time, you can definitely just differentiate it and get the acceleration in terms of time, space, etc. U, v, w, all if they are known as a function of position and time. But mathematical exercise is not exactly the conceptual thing that we are looking for here. So if you consider this particular expression, we will try to bring out a physical perspective of this and see that how we can generalize this for any Eulerian description of any field. Here the field is velocity, but instead of velocity, if we are talking about any other field, we can apply similar considerations. So if you see, there are two types of terms which come up in the expression for acceleration. So one is the time derivative, which is the unsteady component of the acceleration. So sometimes it is given different names, that is the temporal whatever. Physically, it means that it is related to that specific functional dependence of u with time. But a velocity field, which is not a function of time, can also give rise to acceleration. How? That is reflected by the three terms which are accumulated here, but I will tell you qualitatively first, or physically first, that what does it mean. So first of all, there is no time dependence in the latter terms, and it is something which is conflicting with our general concept or perception about acceleration. Because the first definition of acceleration in school level that all of us have learned is that acceleration is nothing but the time rate of change of velocity, right? So acceleration, if it is the time rate of change of velocity, but velocity is not a function of time, then how can you have acceleration? So the catch is that the acceleration is the time rate of change of velocity of an identified Lagrangian particle. And here we are writing acceleration in terms of Eulerian variable. So here u is not u of a particle, but u of the flow at a given point. So what happens to the fate of a particle? So if you have a particle here, I'm just giving an example, say particle at some point of time is at the point 1, and at a different instant of time it goes to p2. What I am describing with respect to a particle is because this is how we are familiar in understanding the concept of acceleration. So the particle goes to the point p2. Okay. So when the particle goes to the point p2, and we are interested to give a Lagrangian, Eulerian description of the velocity, acceleration, etc., say at some point which is in between the the p1 and p2 in the locus of the particle. So if we keep the time interval delta t over which we are doing this experiment, then p1 and p2 will almost converge if this delta t tends to 0. And that is what we talked about during the derivation of this expression. So when that is so, then this circular marked point, p1, p2 all almost converge. But conceptually, there is a difference. Still, there is a difference between P1 and P2. They are virtually coincident, but not exactly coincident, if you take the limit as delta t tends to 0, because delta t is not equal to 0. So they are virtually coincident. If they are virtually coincident, then when the particle goes from P1 to P2, then at the point P1, there is a velocity, which is a function of the space, time, etc. And at the point P2, there is a different velocity. Even if it is a if it is not a function of time, it will still be a function of position until and unless it's a uniform flow. So you have a velocity, even if it is not a function of time. If it is a function of position, there is a difference between the velocity at P1 and there is difference between the velocity at P2, just because the dependence of u on x, y, and z. Okay, so because of the dependence of u on x, y, and z, there is a variation of the velocity of the particle as it goes from the point 1 to the point 2. Simply, it finds a different velocity because of change in position, and it has to get adjusted to that because, as per our assumption, the velocity of the particle is same as the velocity of flow where they are coinciding. So just by virtue of the fact that the particle is going from one point to the other and there is a variation in velocity because of the change in position, the particle will have a change in velocity. So that change in velocity of the particle, just because of its motion with the flow, which is nothing but advection, so that is called as a convective component of acceleration. So this convective component of acceleration is because of the spatial dependence, and simply the physical reason is that the particle over the interval of time, no matter how small, it has gone to a different location where the velocity is different. So this, the second, this collection of terms is because of the spatial dependence. So this is because of non-uniformity of flow. And the first part is because of the unsteady part of the flow. So if it is steady and uniform, there is no acceleration. If it is unsteady, there is acceleration. If it is a non-uniform flow, there is acceleration, and the net acceleration is just a linear superimposition of these two. Now, what about the unsteady component? It is more straightforward to conceptualize that even if the velocity is not changing with position, but changing with time, as time has elapsed, the velocity at a given point will change with time, and that is what will give rise to acceleration. So, in other words, acceleration may be due to two things. One is the variation of velocity at a given point with time, and even if the variation of velocity at a given point with time is not there, the acceleration could be simply because of the physical migration of the fluid particle to a different point where the velocity is different because of the position dependence of velocity. So altogether, this is the total acceleration. And to signify that this is the total acceleration, it is sometimes given by the symbol ddt, which is called as total derivative. Remember that the total derivative concept is only applied to physically describe the change when the description is Eulerian. Mathematically, of course, it is defined in this way. So you can just mathematically write ddt is the partial derivative plus with respect to time plus this one. Okay. So we can infer certain very obvious but very insightful things from here. Number one, that a velocity field which is not a function of time may give rise to acceleration, right? The obvious reason is that even if this is zero, you will have this component. A velocity field which is a function of time may also be non-accelerating. This is something which is not very intuitive, but if you look at this expression, a velocity being a function of time will give a, this partial derivative of u with respect to time, say at a given time and at a given position. Let us give a value, say its value is 1 unit. Now, it may also happen, out of the calculation, that this remaining, this is a function of position and its value is minus 1 unit. So u is a function of x, y, z, time, everything, but the acceleration can be zero just because these two have algebraically nullified. So velocity as a function of time in an Eulerian description doesn't guarantee acceleration. At the same time, velocity not being a function of time can also give rise to acceleration. These two are very different conceptual purviews from standard particle mechanics, just because of using the Eulerian variable for describing them. Okay, now I will try to generalize this a little bit in terms of the mathematical description. So I will just keep this definition of total derivative intact, and then we will write. So if you write this one, so this is the partial derivative with respect to time plus, now if you look at this, You can write in this way, the velocity vector, if you write in terms of the components.
Sir, one W with the last term.
Yes, it has got erased basically. Okay, yes, yeah. Sorry, I forgot to write it. You are correct. Okay. So, so if you write ui plus vj plus wk, so why we have written this is because this is the velocity vector v written in terms of its three scalar components. And I am taking a dot product of that with this one. So I am sure all of you are familiar with unit vectors because these are you know, in school level these are taught. Just I want to tell you that, you know, why I am using ijk here is because in school level it is normally symbolized as ijk. So no matter at what level you have last read it, you can follow it. Normally in advanced level in you know, mechanics, advanced these mechanics books, these are written as e. With the unit vector, so e1, e2, e3, or ex, ey, ez. So basically, what they are meaning is that you know, along x you have a vector of length 1, along y you have a vector of length 1, and along z you have a vector of length 1. They are symbolized by this. That's all. Whatever symbol you want to use is up to you. I am using ijk because of simplicity and because of the familiarity with the school level study of vector algebra. So if you now take a dot product of these two, so if you see, so this u is coming with this one, so this is so why I have written it in this way is because, see, this expression has a limitation. The limitation is that it is coordinate system dependent. This is a Cartesian coordinate system dependent expression. So if we are using a different coordinate system, say a spherical polar coordinate system or a cylindrical polar coordinate system, this expression will be different. And because it will be different, the same formula you cannot apply. But if you are writing a vector expression, so this is sometimes we call it del operator. In a more formal way it is called as nabla operator, but you can call it del operator, not a problem, so long as you know what it is. So this is this operator, capital delta. So this is also called as nabla operator. Sometimes, you know, you give a vector sign at the top, but just for, you know, writing convenience, most of the times I will not do it. Just like this, I will write with an understanding that this is a vector operator. So this can be written as this one. So you have a time derivative and a vector operation of the velocity field with this nabla operator. So this operates on what? It depends on what is that variable with which you are differentiating. So what it all means is that we have now generalized a mathematical description of this, that whatever may be that function, its total derivative is same as its partial derivative plus this one. So this is something which is a generalization of this expression. And see, this is an expression of mathematics. See, this is the beauty of mathematics that we have discussed a physical concept of acceleration, but through that physical concept we have abstracted a mathematical expression. See, this mathematical expression directly doesn't understand the physics. This is just a function, right? This is just a function. Function of position and time. A general function of position and time. A general vector, it is a scalar function, but we can convert it into a vector function also, that I will show in a moment. But for the time being, a general scalar function of position and time, we could write this identity without giving it a physical basis. And acceleration is just one example by which we can give a physical basis to this kind of expression. So we have written the expression for acceleration along x by writing this as, by taking this function as u. If you take this function as v, so what will be, so let me write it u here, so that this is a specific example that you remember. So this is acceleration along x. Similarly, acceleration along y is this one. So in place of u, it is vc. You are using the same mathematical expression, only the function changes. That is the generalization. And acceleration along z. See, x, y, z we are using because we are using u, v, w, but you could use any other thing because this is just a vector expression. So it is not specifically dependent on the particular coordinate system. Now, say you are interested about the acceleration vector. If you are interested about the acceleration vector, so acceleration vector will have its three components, scalar components. I'm just writing in Cartesian. See, I'm trying to do one thing, and as a specific teaching measure. And if you have a bit of maturity in thinking, you will be easily following my mind. I am trying to put up the Cartesian coordinate as a simple example because it is easy for you to follow, but trying to generalize it at the end in terms of a vector expression which you can apply in a coordinate free manner. Coordinate system independent manner rather, not coordinate free, coordinate system independent manner. So acceleration along x I means this. So first of all, let us collect all these time derivative terms. We have collected and individuals are multiplied with the respective unit vectors and added. Let me just tell you certain things. See, all of you study mathematics, but mathematics, this is a different way of perceiving mathematics that I will train you through this course. When you study mathematics, you study normally as a, as a formal way of solving some problems. But I will tell you that, the deeper meaning of mathematical, every mathematical concept is something which can actually tell you numerous physical concepts. So why we can write a vector as a sum of these three scalar components just added together. See, one scalar component along x, another along y, and another z. So we have multiplied by their respective unit vectors to convert them to a vector and simply added. Now why do you think that is this addition should work? We are all trained from school that this addition should work, and we have all believed it. But have we ourselves asked any question at that level that why that addition should work? Because this is like sometimes adding apple with orange, right? Something along x, we are adding something along y, and then something along z. How does it work? It simply works because the unit vectors along x, y, and z are three mutually independent basis vectors. That means that one is not dependent on the other. That is, whatever is happening along x, you can consider that independently. Whatever is happening along y, that you can consider independently, add, subtract, whatever. Whatever is happening along z, that also you can add, consider independently. You can add, subtract, and just do it. And then you combine all these together. So this is the hallmark of linear independence. That is, the basis vectors I, j, k are linearly independent vectors. And why they are linearly independent vectors? Because in a geometrical space, if you represent them, they are orthogonal. That means if you draw them, they are simply perpendicular to each other. That orthogonality gives them linear independence. See, these are all generalized concepts of linear algebra, but you can apply it to vector algebra as a very specific physical example. So that is why you can simply add them, because they are linearly independent. So that is why we are adding, first of all, the time components. Let us add the spatial components. So plus now v dot lambda. Now, this will be multiplied with I, this with j, and this with k. Right? So ui plus bj plus wk. So what it means is that now you are arriving at an expression A, so you can see that whatever we initially thought that should be applicable to a scalar function can also be generalized to be an operator equally valid for a vector function. So you can, for example, this you can write as ddt, let me just write it with a different color so that it is So this is actually the most general definition of acceleration. Okay, the generality of this comes from the fact that this is coordinate system independent. So for example, if you are interested for the spherical, cylindrical, etc., just what you have to do is to use the expression for the Nabla operator for that coordinate system, and you will get the detailed algebraic expression. So that is the beauty of this, that this is very general. We started with a Cartesian example, but we came up with a final form which can be used for any. So with this understanding, let us try to solve a problem which may not directly be related to acceleration, but something which is conceptually related. So let me just read out the problem, and I will write the basic matter in the whiteboard. So you have, so this is a problem. So you have the temperature field T is equal to xy plus z plus 3t in Kelvin units. It is given like this, where x, y, z are in meter, and t is in second. Okay. So this is given. So this simply tells that you have a say a flow domain in which how temperature is varying with position and time. Okay. So this is given to you. So non-isothermal domain where temperature is varying with position and time. You have the velocity within this domain in the same domain is given by xyi plus zj plus phi t k. This in meter per second, where again x, y, z are in meter and t is in second. So essentially the x, y, z, t, what you substitute in these functions are some numbers where the units of numbers are given separately. So now the question is, a particle is located at 2 minus 2 comma 1, all in meter. Meter. Okay. A particle is located at time equal to 2 seconds. Okay. The question is, what is the rate at which the temperature of that particle is changing? I'm not writing the full sentence, there is a bit more, that is at that location and at that time. Okay. So the problem is quite clear that you have a temperature field given in terms of position and time. You have a velocity field, a particle is located there at 2 seconds, that is at 2 minus 2, 1. That particle at that time, what is the rate at which its temperature is changing? So, I mean, you try to work on that for maybe 1 or 2 minutes, and then I will get back to the solution. So have you completed solving the question?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Can one of you systematically describe about the conceptual way of solving the problem? Any one of you can volunteer and discuss. Whoever wants. So you can raise your hand, and if I see your name, I will just. So any who wants? Okay, Ruby's Shakya, yeah.
So, hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, so we can use the expression d by dt with any variable is equal to dou by dt, any variable plus v dot del, any variable. So, in that empty space, we can add this temperature, and then we can differentiate the time, okay. This temperature, and all the
Very
mathematical
yes.
thing we can do.
Yes. Now, can you explain that physically why? Of course, what you have said is perfect. I mean, there is absolutely no error. So let me write it somewhere. I really do not know how to scroll down this one, but I can erase some part and write it here. So this is what is the formula that we will apply to solve this problem. That is all right. Now, can you give a physical basis to this, that why? See, the question is the, let me underline, what is the rate at which the temperature of the particle is changing? So why? That should be governed by this formula and not this one.
Actually, sir, the temperature is dependent on the position and the time itself. So, and it is a scalar quantity. So, if we substitute that temperature over this one dot del t, so it will become a vector quantity, and then we can solve it.
No. I mean, that is all right. So, yeah. I have no doubt about the mathematical applicability of this formula, right? Because this is a and this is a general, to definition of total derivative of a function. In this case, scalar function, we also define something for a vector function. So there is no doubt about that. The question is really, why in this case this should reflect the rate at which temperature of the particle is changing? Physically, only physics, no mathematics. So if you see, you can unmute and let me just tell about this. So again, what does this formula physically tell? It tells that the change in temperature as encountered by a particle could be a combination of two reasons. One is that even if the temperature is not varying with position, at a given point it may change with time, and therefore there will be a change of temperature of the particle, simply because at a given point the temperature is changing with time. On the other hand, with time the particle goes to a different position. At that different position it finds a different temperature, because the temperature is also a function of position here. And because over that time the particle has gone to a different position at which the temperature is different, there is a rate of change of temperature due to position. Why that is coming? That is coming because you are using the Eulerian description not just for the temperature field, but velocity field, but also for the temperature field. So what it means is that you are calculating the change of temperature because of a combination of the change at a given point with time, or the migration of a particle to a different location where the temperature is different just because the position dependence of temperature. And these two different locations are actually infinitesimally close to calculate this one, because you are taking delta t tends to zero in deriving this. That means actually these two different points are almost converging, but they are not the same. And because the capital T is different for those two points, that is why you are having this component of this change of temperature. So the total rate of change of temperature of the particle is because of the time dependence, which is quite straightforward, but In addition, also because of the position dependence of temperature, that the particle over that small time delta t goes to a different position. How does it go? It goes by fluid flow, because you have to remember that this is a special particle which has no relative motion with the fluid, and therefore it moves passively with the fluid flow. And that is how the particle goes to a different location at a different time. Normally the particle will not be able to go if the velocity is zero. The particle is able to go to a different location is because the velocity is non-zero. And therefore that position dependence comes into play because of the fluid velocity. Had this not been there, even if the temperature was a function of position, that would not give rise to any total change. Had the particle not been in a position to migrate to a new location, then it would have been confined in a particular place, and then it will be that only the time dependence. Because it could migrate to a different location, you will get the position dependence also. So anyway, but the remaining is very straightforward algebra of solving the problem. You just differentiate and put the values and you will get the answer. So let us maybe quickly work out another problem before we stop this class. So this is problem number 2. So you have this as two parallel circular plates. So this is circular, the edge view is like a line. These are circular plates, but very large radius. Both these are parallel. And there is a gap between the two plates, which is not fixed. Why it is not fixed? Because the top plate is coming down with a constant velocity v0. So that means h is changing with time, it is actually reducing with time, because the bottom plate is fixed and the top plate is coming down. And of course, in between you have a fluid, and the fluid is this fluid is squeezed out. So there is a fluid, and this fluid is squeezed out radially. I mean, it will be squeezed out because when the top plate is coming down, where will the fluid go? It will have only the chance of being radially pushed out. Otherwise, mass balance will not be satisfied. Now, because of this squeezing of the fluid, so if we draw a center line like this, say this is the center line, these are all circular. So at a given radius from the center line, if you draw the velocity variation, say this is the velocity which is observed. Let us say this is u, and this u is observed to be only a function of r. That means the variation with respect to the height, the gap between the two plates, that is ignored. So when that can be ignored or when that cannot be ignored, we will learn in more details when we study about the role of viscosity of the flow. Right now we are studying kinematics. So we'll take this as an assumption that, well, this is what is observed, that this u at a given radial location is a function of the radial location only and not a function of the vertical thing. So the question is that at that r equal to some small r, some given value, what is that acceleration along x? So x is like this one, this is the x direction. Okay. So the fluid, because the u is a function of r, what is the acceleration? I mean, acceleration will be there because of position dependence here. Now, I will just tell this problem can be complicated to a great extent if we want to complicate, but it can be also simplified to a great extent if you just give a simple physical understanding. So imagine that you have imaginary sort of location like this, which I have hatched, which is a circular domain of radius r and height h. H is a function of time. So at that instant, because the plate, top plate is pushing down, if you imagine that there is a region, so let me just put a dotted line like this. So if you have a fixed region, because the plate is pushing down, the plate will push some flow through it. What is that flow which is being pushed across the dotted line because the plate is moving down? It is nothing but V naught. So it is the velocity times the cross-sectional area, that is pi r square. This is the volume flow rate, velocity into cross-sectional area, that times the density. Let us assume that the density is constant. So forget about the density's role. So let us say density constant. It is not changing. So this is the volume flow rate. This multiplied by the density, let us say rho, is the mass flow rate. So that mass has come in across this dotted line. And because the density is not changing, so what will happen? This mass will be squeezed out. So this mass is being squeezed out across the surface of an imaginary cylinder. So what is that velocity at which it is squeezing out? U. What is the area over which it is squeezing out? 2 pi r into h. This is the surface of the imaginary cylinder. Remember, h is a function of time, it is not a constant, but at a given time. So at a given time, you can get from here, so rho you can cancel, u is equal to v0 into r by 2h. Okay. So can you tell u is a function of what? Position, function of time, what? Any one of you. You can just raise your hand and tell u is a function of what? Okay, Rahul?
It's a function of position.
Anybody else?
Sir, both.
Both. So, if you see here, so let me get back to the writing thing. So, u is a function of r where the position is there, but remember h is a function of time. So, u is actually a function of both position and time. Explicitly position, but implicitly time. So this consideration, this physical understanding is very important when you will calculate the acceleration. So let us calculate the acceleration. Just free some space here so that I will write the expression for acceleration. So acceleration along x. So instead of x, it is r, right? We are calling it radial coordinate. So x and r are the same, okay? And there is no y, z, etc. dependence. So acceleration along x is like acceleration along r. So I just replace x by r. Conceptually, there is no problem because there is just a one-dimensional matter. So I will just replace it with this one. So So let us just calculate this and see what is the outcome. Just one step, but very, very important step. So if you do this, let me write it here. So the time derivative, so let us just write this expression somewhere, v0 into r by 2h. So the time derivative, the first term, so this is what? So h is a function of time, so we should do this implicit differentiation. So v0, so minus v0 r by 2 h square into this one. Okay. And the next one is this one v0, so plus v0 r by 2 h. And then the differentiation with respect to r is v0 by 2 h. And if you see now, very important step, this is nothing but the rate of change of h with respect to time is minus v0, right? Because h is decreasing with time and the rate of decrease is nothing but the velocity of the plate. So you have in totality v0 square r by 2h square plus v0 square r by 4h square. Whatever it comes, then you know the rest is straightforward. See, where people can make a conceptual mistake is ignoring this one, and this is so this is where you have to be very very careful about the dependence of position, time, etc. So let us stop this class, and if you have some questions, we can. Look forward to that, or if you want to sort of leave the class, that is also okay, so not a problem. And otherwise, you can just stay there maybe for 1 or 2 minutes if you have any question. Or otherwise, we will meet again tomorrow. So if there are no questions, let us stop today's class and we will meet tomorrow as per our regular class hour. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.